Well, now that we've learned what the benefits of underfloor insulation are, it's time to think about what selection criteria we might apply when deciding what kind of underfloor insulation we want to use. So let's take a look at that now. Here's some criteria that you might want to think about. Firstly, what is the lifespan of the product? Hopefully it's going to be at least as long as the anticipated lifespan of the home that you're installing it to. Now, it might be a lot of fun underfloor, but it might not too. So it's a job that you really want to do well once only. Okay, so the longevity of the product is really important. Also, the longevity of the fixing method. It's okay to have a great long-lasting product, but if it's not in the right place, it's not going to be effective. So the fixing method is really important as well. Now, you could spend a lot of money on a product that maybe is really difficult to fit well, or maybe impossible to fit well, so that the overall effectiveness of that product may be reduced. So you might think that it's an R2.5 product, but you might only be getting considerably less than that if you can't actually fit it properly. Moisture retention is something you might want to think about as well. If, for example, you have some kind of flood in the house, you want the moisture that ends up in the floorboards to dissipate from both sides. However, if you've got an impermeable layer under the floor, well, that might take a considerable period of time for it to dry out from the top only. Fire resistance, of course, is something that's top of mind every summer, and particularly if you live out in the countryside. So how is the product going to behave if there's embers? Is it actually going to catch fire and burn your house down from underneath? Or is it going to be safe? Reducing drafts might be a thing as well. With older homes, the tongue and groove boards can shrink and move, and there can be actually a draft issue from between the boards. Also, sometimes someone's put a saw through them for whatever purpose, and so that is really a big draft issue. So is the product that you're going to choose, is it going to reduce or eliminate that draft, or is it going to have no effect? Vermin resistance is something that you really want to think carefully about. And that's for a couple of reasons, okay? So, you know, mice and rats are everywhere to a smaller or larger extent. If you're in the countryside, you know, you can have a plague of mice. But even in the city, there are mice and rats. And if you or a neighbor has a large compost heap, then that can be a breeding ground for them as well. So there's a couple of things about vermin. One is, are they going to attack your product and maybe take it away for nesting material? And the second thing is your product actually going to provide a nice cozy home for them to live in? So obviously we want a no to both those things, because you don't want vermin living under your floor. It's not good. People safe material. Okay, so underfloors come in such a wide variety of formats, ranging from very tall ones where you might need a ladder to actually reach the floor, all the way down to standing up or crouching down, all the way down to a really tight crawl. The tighter the space, the more important it is to have a really people-friendly material, because the closer it gets to your face, the more important it is that it's not a feral thing that's going to give you an endless amount of irritation. Finally, also it would be really good that the material have some eco-friendly aspect. So maybe it's got some recycled component in it, in the manufacture of it, and maybe it can be recycled at the end when your building perhaps gets demolished, and hopefully the materials are retrieved and either reused or recycled. Now finally, a really important aspect of underfloor insulation is the joist spacing. So the floorboards sit on the joists, and the joists sit on bearers, and the bearers sit on stumps or piers. So that's the structure of a subfloor. The insulation often goes between the joists or under the joists. Okay, so if it's going under the joists, then the joist spacing doesn't really matter very much. Materials that go between the joists, it does matter. Okay, so some materials are flexible and able to be accommodated by different joist widths, and others are not so good at that. So that's a really important aspect of underfloor insulation. A lot of material does fit between the joists, and so it's important to know the general joist spacing, but also be aware that in most subfloors, the general joist spacing is not the only joist spacing, because there will be ones that are considerably less, and there may well be some that are somewhat more than the general spacing. So it's important that the product that you choose has a way of accommodating the different joist spacings that you are no doubt going to find under your floor. So there's some selection criteria to think about. In the next section, where we look at section 3, we're going to look at, well, what types of insulation products are actually available, and what are the pros and cons of them for your underfloor.